on the Revolver 50cc from Great Plains. Now I've already started on this bottle and worked on it a little bit last night. We'll go over here in a minute what I accomplished. First thing, when I start to work on a model again for the next day or whatever, I like to clean up all my tools because it really makes a mess. All the things you need when you're building and working on an airplane. So, if you'll clean up your mess a little bit before you start, it kind of starts you off on a clean slate. It's a good way to get started. So I always clean up my work area when I first start. I even put up my tools. Now granted, you're going to need immediately, you're going to need some of these tools again. But if you clean them up, you always know where they are. Seems to work real good for me. And I will go over here in just a minute what I accomplished. Started on this plane last night. Lately, I've been building about a plane a week, which is pretty good on these bigger planes. It takes more hours than you think. Okay, and of course I like country music, so I have a little music on. Make it a relaxing thing. A lot of the parts you're going to be working with are real small. I use reading glasses. Some of you may not need them. Okay, the work area is cleaned up a little bit. Ready to go. I usually, when I start on a model, I open up the box and I make sure everything's in the box, make sure it's not missing anything. A lot of the places that you order from, this is a spinner that came with this plane, it's a massive one. A lot of the places, they'll give you 30 days from the day that you ordered it. So it's really good. Now, a lot of us let these boxes sit around before we start on them for quite some time. And if you do that, you're in trouble if you're missing something. So, as a rule, it's much better to go ahead and look your stuff over when you get it. When you order this model, if it's no matter if it's going to be several months before you start working on it, go ahead, get into the box. Look it over, pull the pieces out, check everything, make sure everything's there. If it's not, you can call where you ordered it from and let them know, and they'll usually take care of it. But now, with Tower Hobbies and Horizon Hobbies, as far as I know, they'll tell you it's been longer than 30 days and there's nothing they can do to help you. Okay, with that said, I started on this model last night. I like to go by the books. It makes it really easy. Of course, I use a lot of my own ideas as I go, but there's usually a reason why they want you to go by certain steps. Okay, I started with what they asked you to start with, which is these little plates they say to build the wings. And to build the wings, you start off with these little hatches. These little hatches, let me zoom in a little bit. Okay,
These are really nice. And a lot of the planes include these, okay? And it's the first thing they tell you to build, okay? Now, there's several things they do on these. There's these little wooden blocks, okay? Now you have to make a little cutout so your wire can go in, okay? Now I usually center my arm, center my servo, okay? Center my arm here, okay? And then I set my wood blocks in there, okay? I make my notch. I wrap my servo with 3 wraps of electrical tape to give it a little space between the blocks and also a little space between the hatch, because you'll find out that they vibrate from the engine vibration if you don't do that. Okay, now I set, holding them against my servo and pushing my servo against it, I draw little lines around them. Okay, little ink lines. And then I use a very, very small amount of CA to tack them down, okay? After I tack them down, I drill my holes through the front, okay? I put those screws in it. Then I drill my holes for my servo screws. Now, they tell you to put a drop of CA in this wood after you drill your holes, 1/16th hole. I don't agree with that, basically, because this wood is so hard that even without a drop of CA in your holes, you'll almost strip the heads out of your screws when you put them in. You have to be very careful putting your screws in. And even, you can't really drill them any bigger than 1/16th, but you can take a 1/16th bit and waller the holes out a little bit to where your screws will go in. But I don't put CA in those, in these particular type of wood. I'll have to look and see what kind of wood that is. It's really, it looks like walnut or something. But anyway, I put my screws in, okay, and then I check my fit. I make sure that my servo will tip out of there with my hole for my wire. I make sure that in the future, if I need to replace a servo, that I can get it in and out. There's a small amount of room here and here, a very small amount of room. There's a very small amount of room underneath the servo. Okay, and once I get all that done, I actually leave the servo attached to the wood blocks. I very carefully take these screws out. I take those screws out. I very carefully pry the wood blocks off, still attached to the servo, okay? And then, because I put the little drop of CA, remember to hold them down, to tack them down for a second. Okay, and then I use a very small amount of 30-minute epoxy, and you have to use a small amount because it'll seep out. I put a little bit underneath, okay, and then I put it back on. I put my screws back on. Now, they tell you to put CA in these holes also. I don't. I actually smear a little bit of the 30-minute epoxy down in these holes also. I just don't have that good of luck with the CA in this particular type of wood. It's too hard. There's no need for it. So I use a little bit of the 30-minute epoxy. I put the screws back in. I put the servo back in place. I check all my little gaps. I make sure I've got a little bit of a gap there on the servo. I make sure I've got a little bit of gap there, and then I let it set for a little bit more than 30 minutes before I complete assembly. Now, on these arms, you make sure they're in the center of the groove. You make sure they hit right in the middle of these openings, and that'll give you a full throw. Okay, pay also attention which way they want you to mount these in the wings. Really pay close attention in the book of how they're telling you to mount these servos, because there's usually a reason which way they want you to turn them in the wings, which way the servo sits. And then I also, in the process, and I see this covering is coming up a little bit, fooling with these plates, being that they've got covering on them, tends to loosen up the covering. So I usually heat my iron up and iron them down as I go, to keep them the covering nice and smooth on them. Also, make sure, and it does happen some, and these plates warp a little bit as you attach stuff, as you attach your servo and everything. In the process, if something happens that it's warped too much and it might not bolt down, you might have to sand these little wood blocks a little bit to make them truer, to where it won't warp your wood block. Now, usually you can flip these wood blocks over and it'll have a more true side that will work a little better. Anyway, I assembled both of those last night. Now I'm using what they call Power HD servos, and I get those from Toy Belt Models. These are very good, very reliable, real high output servo. They're 246 ounces at 6 volt, which now I'm running mostly 6 volt nickel metal hydride, 2000 milliamp Hydromax in a lot of my planes, but I'm converting to life batteries, which I get through eBay. They're 6.6. That makes these very strong servos. These servos come from Toy Build Hobbies, 246 ounce at 6 volt, and they're very reasonably priced, as opposed to some of the other servos. I've had pretty good luck with these. Okay, now, I'm getting ready to make a couple of my extension leads. Now, they tell you that you will need to make.
Let me get this camera set a little better here to where you can see me.
Ladies, are you ready to reclaim control? If bladder control problems are keeping you from enjoying life, you are not alone. 1 in 6 adult women suffer from bladder control. Taylor Surgical Arts can help give you the power to reclaim control. Interstim therapy for urinary control has helped thousands gain control of their bladder problems since 1997. This outpatient procedure is covered by all insurance companies, Medicare and
okay. They're saying that you need to make 2 12-inch servo extension leads. Now, you can buy these leads, and they're not that expensive. But I like to make my own. I buy my wire through Tower Hobbies. I buy high-tech 20-gauge wire. And then I buy all my connectors and ends from servosandstuff.com. I actually got my crimp pliers and stuff from from Tower Hobbies. Okay. Now, the book says that I need to make 2 12-inch extensions. Attach 2 12-inch servo extensions, aileron servo, and secure the connector using tape or heat shrink. Okay, now, I always make them at very least an inch longer. I make them an inch longer so that I don't have any problem with reaching my receiver wherever it might be. Now, a lot of times I check to make sure everything's going to be long enough. These are the ones in the wings. The ones in the wings just have to be long enough to reach inside the fuselage, and you're going to hook them where the ailerons hook up on your receiver. But anyway, here we go. We've got 20-gauge wire, high-tech. We've got our connector ends, both male and female. Okay, get those from servos and stuff. Got my pliers and everything. Got these from eBay. Got these from Tower Hobbies. Okay, now, I'm going to make some leads. I usually make them at very least an inch longer. So first of all, I cut my wire lengths. I'm going to need 2, like I said, inch longer. I make 2 13-inch pieces.
Suffering from flickering lights, breakers tripping, or not enough outlets, it's time to call the doctor, the electrical doctor, that
cut
is.
Cut my wire and lengths.
Speed has the cure for all your electrical ailments, and we make house calls.
There's 12, there's 13, okay. Okay, you just use the other piece of wire to get your other length. Assuming it was right in the first place. Okay. 2 12-inch lengths, 13-inch lengths, excuse me. Again, keep your tools put up, keep them neat. You'll be able to use them when you need them.
Across from Snap Beard and Funeral Home, East Highway 76 in Branson.
Call
973-0333.
I use a tackle box, more or less. The plain old tackle boxes, the bigger ones have these, where a lot of these containers can go in. And I find that each container I can put different stuff applying to my airplane builds, and I can carry them with me at the field because I take everything with me to the field because that's when you're going to need it. Or one of your buddies is going to need it. So I take everything with me. Here we go. First of all, I always take and see what I'm making. You have to compare your ends. See what you're going to
tonight, partial clearing, cold to below 15, and tomorrow looks better. Sunshine, some clouds, not quite so cold in the afternoon.
Now again, I have to use reading glasses.
Sunny and milder on Thursday.
Because I can't see things up close.
I'm AccuWeather.com meteorologist Maggie Johnson on the Best Country 102.9.
Okay.
As we take a look at the 102.9, the Z Keller radar, it looks clear right now across the Ozarks and 21 here at the studios.
Radar presented by.
I start by pulling my wire back. Now I'm going to zoom in a little bit for this.
We're having a Valentine's Day bids for bargain sale.
So you can see.
February the 14th. When you spend $50 or more, simply use the code word LOVE and save 10% on your entire purchase.
For more, should do it. Okay. Now, I pull my wires back about an inch so they're separated. Okay, I take my wire strippers. Yeah, very carefully and make sure that I'm using the right size. Now on these, it's usually the smallest. And I strip off a little bit more than an eighth inch of wire. Okay. And then I try to twist it so it doesn't fray in the process of using it. Now I also, there's something else you're going to need when you're doing this. Let me find them. We keep a small pair of needle nose pliers. Here they are. And when you're crimping, you'll need a small pair of needle nose pliers too, and this helps greatly. I'll show you here in just a second. Okay. Now, I've stripped my wire back about an eighth inch. A little more, a little less, depending on what works for you. Okay, and then I twist. I have to push my fingers together and twist this wire to get it to where it's not going to fray on me, okay? Now, I figure out what I'm making here. Now, that end is a female, okay? So I need to make a male end, okay? So go to my male terminals, okay? I get one set of all the components out. Now, actually, these break off, so I set the whole thing out. Okay, I get one set of the components out. One of the plugs. Okay, I'll try to see which way the plugs are going to plug in. Okay, it looks like the... I always look at my connectors with the little holders sticking up at me. That way I've got a way to tell which way it should be done. Okay, and I put these together, male to male, male to female. Okay, male to female. Looks like my negative wire will be on my left. The red's always in the middle. The control wire's on the right side on my connectors. Okay, so I break off one terminal. Okay. Now it's very important on these connectors to get the part of the wire with the wire coating through the first tab. Okay, you get it through the first tab and you lay the part of the strip wire in the second tab. Okay, now I take a little pair of needle nose pliers and I pinch it on the part with the wire coating. Okay, it works. Back in there.
The Ozarks Best Country, 102.9 is east.
Okay, first set of tabs on the wire coating. Second set of tabs on the wire itself. I squeezed the first set of tabs just enough to hold the wire in place. Okay, now, the open part goes up on your pliers. Go back to the back part. Squeeze it down. Okay, that puts the clamp on the wire coating. Okay, come up forward to the second part, which is the wire itself. Put the clamp on the wire. Now, I always do it again. Go one more time to make sure it's crimped down good. Don't want these coming loose. Make sure your wire doesn't protrude much past the second set of little fold-down tabs. The reason being is this is the part of the, you know, the part of the terminal that snaps into the terminal end, and if you get it much past that, it'll get in the way of it snapping in. Okay, now I also turn mine up. I pay attention to which way they would turn on the wire to lay the wire flat. Is what that does, it keeps these from twisting every which way as they go in. It makes them go in nice and straight. Okay, let's do another one. Strip them out 1/8 inch. Okay, twist the wire. Get another terminal. Make sure my direction of my wire is right so my wire will lay flat. And my wire coating through the first set of tabs. The wire itself lays in the second set of tabs. Take my hand with those pliers and squeeze it in on the coating to hold it so I can crimp it. Okay, put the open area up, crimp the back tabs first. Now it's hard to hold these straight as they go in and crimp, and that's okay. If it turns a little bit, just lightly crimp it and then crimp it again and it'll make it lay right. Okay, now second set of tabs. Okay, now I do it again. Don't want these coming loose. Okay, there's that one. Now let's do it again. 1/8 inch. Twist your wire. Now, if you lay these in your terminals and there's a couple little wires sticking out, or you accidentally cut it a little too long that time, after you twist it, just take a little bit off of it to get your length exactly right. Twist it a little bit more. Okay, get a terminal off here. This is a male end I'm making. Make sure your wire is laying in the right direction so it'll lay flat and pop your tabs and your terminals and your terminal in. Put your wire coating in the first set of tabs. Wire itself into the second set of tabs. Needle nose to crimp it on the coating. Pulls up on your crimping pliers. Crimp the back one first and the front one second, and then crimp them again to make sure. Okay, there's three terminals. Now, look at my servo end. Look at the end I'm making. Okay, black first. With the little button up, push them in until they snap. And you can see this little assembly snap into place. Now the male. Make sure these little things push down, these little plastic things. They'll make a clicking noise when they do. And red always goes in the middle. Make sure it clicks in. Okay, yellow
always goes on one side. It's the control wire. Okay, make sure these little tabs push down. Now, make sure that it plugs into your servo in, because that's what you're making. Does appear to. Now, put my pin on. Okay, there's a little bump inside of this one here, and you'll see it lays right in this opening. And it will go in and snap in on the male one. Make sure it snaps on, okay? Make sure. Actually made that one backwards. So, you take a dull hobby knife, you push in, there's that little bump, you're trying to release it. So you release it. Okay, I'm back. Working on the 50cc revolver. It's a Great Plains model. I had to take some of the footage off my camera to make some room, so I've accomplished several things here. Yeah, I've actually got a few things I can't show you. Okay. Earlier, I was making my servo ends. Okay. Once I got my servo ends made, I take heat shrink and I shrink over the top of where the plugs go together, and I use a little blow dryer thing I found that's used for stamps. It works real good on the heat shrink, and that's the way I hold the terminals together where they plug for my extensions that I made for the servos. Okay. You can also use, a cigarette lighter, that works. You can use your heat gun you use for covering, or almost any kind of heat source, but this is a cheap way to hold your ends together so they don't come apart in your wing. You definitely want to do that. Okay, so I made my 13-inch extensions, but called for 12, and I made 13s. Okay, and then I took and I threaded my leads through my wings. Now some models have a string that they put through this opening so you can pull your servo lead through the ends. Now I tie my ends up through the middle through the center wire and loop it. That way when you're pulling it through your wing, it pulls straight and not to the side. Now if this string is not there, Or if you accidentally pull the string out, don't worry about it. Is all you have to do is tie anything with a little weight on a piece of string, like I could tie this on a piece of string. Okay, hold your wing up upright and thread this down. The weight of the item and jiggle it will go down through your wing. Once you get that through, you can tie this to your servo wire and pull it through. And in some cases, you might just be able to work your servo wire by itself down through the wing, which is one of these did not have the string, and that's what I had to do, and the other one did. Okay. Next up, they tell you to set these down in the wings, these little plates with your servos, and then you drill these holes. Let me zoom in a little bit. Okay, you drill these four holes with a 16 drill bit. Okay, now I use this little Ryobi drill. This is a very handy item. Now there's several other brands. This is my favorite. Black & Decker makes one, and there's several other brands. This one works real good. It's small, it's handy. You can use a regular drill. The bottom line is 16th inch drill bit. You put your cover on
make it go into place. Now, I've already done this on these. I'm just going it back over it. Make your wire land right so it will go in there. These are a little tight. Have to make the wire lay right to make it go in. Okay. Once you get that snapped into place, you very carefully drill. Now, these are a little over a quarter inch, maybe 3/8. Anyway, you drill no more than you really need. I usually drill a hair further, okay, and I drill these holes and I pay a lot of attention to my angle, because these little square pieces of wood that are down in there are made to catch your screws. You don't want to come through the side of them or anything. You want to keep your angle as you're drilling, so be very careful as you're drilling. You drill those holes, and then you thread these screws in. Before you put a drop of thin CA in the holes, and the reason you screw the screws in is to get your hole size. It does something. It frays the wood to where it'll accept the thin CA. Now this wood they're using is very hard. I could have probably got by without it, but I did it. I drill my holes a hair deeper. I don't use very much thin CA, like one drop per hole. Now I ran into something here that I want to go over. A lot of the hardware that is including with the planes, even with the better brands, is pretty low quality. And you can get by with it in most cases as long as you pay a lot of attention to some things. A lot of the sizing, like on the Phillips head screws, is really not exact. So if you'll, is what I do, I buy several of the cheap bit sets. You can get these at Home Depot, Lowe's, any hardware store, True Value. I get different ones of these cheap sets, and it's what they have is they have several of the bits for the Phillips, which it's mostly Phillips what I've ran into. Okay, and I take the screw when I first start and I look at it very closely and see how well the bit fits the head. Now these bits did not, and it's pretty standard, they didn't fit the heads good at all. So is what I did is I took the bit that was closest to fitting the head of the screw tightly, and I chucked it up in my drill. Okay, and I took my sanding block, and you can do this with a file or anything, take small amounts off. And I did this. Okay, and what this does is this particular head did not fit all the way down in the Phillips head screw well. It didn't fit down in it to work well. So, is what that does, it takes a little bit off the tip and it flattens it out. And I did that until it fit my screws extremely well. And that will make all the difference in the world when you're threading these screws in, not to strip the heads out, because like I said, the hardware is pretty low quality. It just is. Okay. Now, I've already drilled all my holes in both wings. I've already threaded my screws in and removed them in both wings, being very careful not to strip the heads on these screws, because it's very easy to do. All right. So, next up, I need to hook a receiver. And the reason I need to hook a receiver is I want to center my servos, and I want to put my arms on. And this is something that's really odd, and it'll catch you by surprise if you don't watch it. I didn't cut one end off. I'm going to end up cutting one end off of my servo horn to go in here on this place on the wing. But the reason I didn't do this yet, I want to hook my receiver up first and turn my radio on. And with all my trims and sub-trims at zero, I want to mechanically get this arm in a center position 90 degree position on the servo as much as I can. Okay, and is what happens is the little splines inside these, they don't ever line up just exactly. It'll be off to one side or the other. And is what you will find is, let me see if I can move the servo. Handy one. Now again, I'm using Power HD's pretty good low cost servo. Okay, so here's the servo. Now the splines, when you pop them on, you're wanting it to be 90 degrees. Now see, that one's pretty close. But as what will usually happen is one way will be close and one way will be way off. Because those splines. Okay, so see the other way. Now, I want to wait and see which way works best for me. Seeing that they're going to stick up out of the slot in the wing one direction. Now see, that one would work best for me. So I will cut the other end off. Now if I go ahead and I cut an end off, there's a pretty good chance that my splines are going to be off like that, and I'm going to have to sub-trim the heck out of it to get it to be 90 degrees. So wait to cut your horns off until you hook a receiver up and center everything. So that's what I'm going to do now. Now you see why I try to keep my tools picked up. They build up very quickly when you're working on something. So I try to get everything I'm working with picked up intervals while I'm working on stuff. That way I'll have more room for more tools and so on while I'm working on things. You don't do this, pretty soon you've got so many things on your work area that you can't work. Happens really quickly on airplanes. Also use a little Tupperware, any kind of butter dishes. A friend of mine, Terry, gives me these. Any kind of little plastic dishes to put all your hardware in. And then I use a pair of hemostats to pick all the little nuts and bolts out of there as I use them. Okay. Again, right now I'm just getting everything out of the way so I can go ahead and start on something else. Just the things I'm working with. Paying close attention to the instructions. Now, I've built several planes with very little instruction, and you can get by, but it's really nice to have something laying out in detail each step and things to watch for. Don't ever figure that you just know enough and you don't need that. Because there's a pretty good chance you do, no matter how good you are at building. Okay, now, let's see, what radio am I gonna put this airplane on? Yeah, I really need to put one on my futaba. So, I get a, and I've got several, what I call bench batteries laying around. Okay, so I get a battery, I get a receiver. Okay, I get a, and I have several laying around now. I'm gonna get a.
You listen to 129. This is Clay Maxey, Clay Maxey 4. Proud of being Harrison.
This is a little lightweight model airplane switch, and I get these off of eBay. And they come from, actually, I believe they come from Hobby King. And they are okay on smaller planes. I'm not actually going to end up using this one on this plane. I'm just using it for test purposes. And the reason being is, well, actually, these aren't even rated for 7 amp. But I have tested them. They work right up to about 7 amp. And then they start to... they can't carry any more of a load. And in this size of a plane, being a 50cc plane, and using these type of servos, Power HD's 246 ounces of torque at 6 volt, you're going to exceed that amperage really easily. basically when you work in several control surfaces at once. So what's going to happen is when you test your plane, when you're building it, it's not going to happen. But when you're flying it fairly aggressive and you're doing some tricks, you're going to end up with a receiver brownout, which means your receiver doesn't receive enough voltage to work. And the reason that is because all of your servos are actually pulling most of the juice. Now, on a high-tech receiver, they actually give you the ability to hook two batteries up. Now, you can hook two batteries up to any receiver. But on a high-tech, they give one that'll actually isolate the receiver, and you can run the servos off of another battery. That's a really good idea. Now, on most receivers, you could use multiple switches, and you could run multiple batteries for redundancy, and probably take care of that issue with just multiple batteries and multiple switches, which is what some people do. And a lot of receivers don't have a port that says battery. And the reason they don't have that is because you can take a Y harness and you can Y harness in, one of them being your battery in and one of them being your servo channel out. And that's a good, you can bring your battery in any channel, not just a battery in. And you can Y harness it and put it in with whatever servo channel that you're running off of that channel. So you could run multiple ones. But anyway, I've got some switches I will show you at a later time that I get off of eBay that are rated for 15 amp. 15 amp is suitable for the larger planes all the way up to probably all the way up to around 85 cc gas airplanes. Now any bigger than that, they're saying that you're going to run over 20 amp. So these are only almost 7 amp. These are only for the smaller planes. This is not the one I'm actually going to use for this airplane. But I am going to use it right now. Okay, and is what I'm doing is I'm setting up a bench setup to center my servos. So I plug my bench battery in to my switch. Plug my switch. Make sure it's off. Into my receiver. Now pay attention to